Good evening, I'm Jeff Koinange, and this is a special edition of Jeff Koinange Live from the capital of one of Africa's most troubled nations, and yes, indeed, its youngest, Juba, South Sudan. Now, this is a nation that's barely 5 years old, but already they've gone through one civil war and an insurrection less than a month ago. Thousands killed, tens of thousands displaced. The world is asking, what went wrong with South Sudan? So we have a special with the man who holds the key to the future, the president of South Sudan, Salva Kiir. President.
How are you?
How are you, sir?
Nice meeting you.
Good to see you.
So do I too.
You well?
I'm good.
Asante, asante. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome.
So you have changed my seating.
Yeah, we've changed your seating a little bit. We'll return it to its original after. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. How are you?
I'm good.
Yeah?
Pushing on.
Pushing on. Strong.
Because
President, first of all, thank you so much for giving us your time.
You're welcome.
And for inviting us to Juba at this time. I know you're very busy with everything that's been going on.
Thank you. Please.
So the first question a lot of people are asking is, are you in control here?
I'm in control. If I was not in control, you would have not found me here.
But I was saying earlier on in my introduction, a country that's 5 years old, and you've already gone through two very traumatic and serious events. What does that say about South Sudan? What does that say about this country?
It is not the country, but rather than the people. There are people who are power hungry and who would not want to follow the system that people, change power. Peaceful means of changing power. They are too impatient to wait for that.
Yeah. So let's mention these people while we're here. I mean, obviously, Riek Machar, who was your first vice president for a long time. And then up until this past incident on July the 7th, tell us what happened. Because you were both in the palace. You were both here. What happened?
Well, what happened on the 7th, none of us was there. It happened on the road in the checkpoint when his bodyguards went and attacked the checkpoint, which was manned by the national security with some few military police men. So they attacked them. They killed four of them, two from national security, two from the military police, and another, a civilian doctor who was passing by, was shot there. Five of them. That was in the evening of the 7th. In the morning of Friday, there was supposed to be a meeting of the Council of Ministers. We always do it by Friday, every Friday. So that Friday, I canceled the meeting. I said, let the first vice president and the vice president come to me so that we come and see how to put down the tension of what happened last night. And at the same time, Dr. Machar has planned that while we are in the Council of Ministers, his men will come and open fire on all of us.
On everybody.
There will either survive and I will die. And if I die and he survives, then he will declare himself the president of the Republic of South Sudan. But that was aborted by having me cancel the Council of Ministers. So they came here, and this is where we were sitting.
This room?
This room. The first thing he said on the way was that he was afraid of how to pass through the checkpoints. The officer he called assured him that there is no problem. You are the first vice president. Nobody will tamper with your motorcade. So he came, but on the way, where the checkpoint was, he stopped and he said he warns officers from the Joint Military Council. This is a body which was brought in by the agreement. Mm-hmm. A Joint Command Military Council, it consists of his forces and our force. Mm-hmm. So these commanders came to him and they brought him. He was told that, you know, when we reach, you will go in with your official motorcade, consisting of about 10 or 11 vehicles. But the whole bodyguards will remain outside. Mm-hmm. He said, okay. When they reached here, he entered with the close protection, and the rest were left outside. Now, while we were inside here, the forces that were left in his residence came in a convoy of 20 Toyota pickups, full of soldiers, and one ambulance. In that ambulance, there were also arms loaded on, and they were down. Now, outside the fence, they started to spread out, just like in a fighting formation. Mm-hmm. And the colonel who came in the ambulance was now the one directing what was to be done. So he was asking the soldiers who were already down, said, did you cock your guns? And he was speaking in their language. Mm-hmm. And the nearest soldiers to him on my bodyguards were Nuer. And they were hearing whatever he was saying. So the soldiers told him that we did not cock our guns because we have no orders to do that. He started abusing them, that they were cowards and they did not follow up the orders. Because when they were coming, they came with very specific orders. Now one of my bodyguards, who was caught by surprise, said, my brothers, is this thing happening again? Mm. So he got the first bullet shot by this colonel. Mm. He was shot, he fell. The other one who was with him shot the colonel, also dead. That was the beginning of everything.
And their objective was to come in here, mm-hmm, and kill you?
Yes.
That's what they were going to do?
Yes. Dr. Riek Machar himself was armed.
He was armed?
With a pistol. He was armed with a pistol.
So when you heard the shooting, the commotion, what did you do, Mr. President?
We were just sitting, three of us, myself, my two deputies, we were sitting.
Yeah.
Where you remove these chairs,
Yes.
Just here.
And you could hear the shooting?
It is loud, you know, enough to be heard anywhere. Mm. It was heard all over Juba. And then, when the fire intensified, I told them, my brothers, we are very close to the door and to the windows. Let us go in. Mm-hmm. So I let them in, into my office. Let us just go and sit there.
Wow.
We went and sat.
Yeah.
And it became difficult that we could continue with the meeting. So I told them, let us leave it to subside, and we will resume.
Now, didn't anyone come in and tell you, Mr. President, you know, we're under fire, or they're firing, or there's something going on outside?
Well, we were using telephones, and so right away from the first bullet when it started, we got the information of what was happening.
Yeah.
And so we remained.
Were you afraid, Mr. President? Were you worried?
I was not. I would have not controlled anybody if I was worried. I was just sitting as I'm sitting with you. I have no gun, but I was not worried.
So, okay, let's go back to your history with Dr. Machar. You never liked each other, did you?
No, it is something he started in 2012. But all this time we were together.
Always. And you were friends?
We were comrades in arms.
Okay, when did things turn around? When did things change?
It was the time when he had wanted to change the leadership. Mm-hmm. That he started to speak in the media that I should now step down.
Yeah.
And leave somebody to complete whatever that has not been done.
Right. Mm-hmm. So he left, he fled, he's in wherever, I'm sure you know where he is, in the mountains, and you have a new vice president.
I don't know where he is.
You sure you don't know? Is it true you have ordered an arrest warrant on him? Is it true?
No.
You have not?
I have not. Recently?
Yes.
I never.
So, are you looking for him?
Well, he's fighting, somebody fighting you. Mm. How can you look for him?
Yeah.
People were saying, we have to sit down and talk. I declared a ceasefire and called him. I have issued so many appeals to him as the first vice president to come back to Juba, so that we come and continue with the implementation of the agreement which we signed. So there is no way that I could go and look for him.
Yeah. So what is it now between you and him? Is it all out war now?
I'm not fighting him, but I'm on defense because I'm defending the country, and should he come with whatever military force that he has, he will also be met with such a force.
And that's the fear among many, especially people who are not from South Sudan, Mr. President, is the fact that all this fighting since 2013, people are wondering, what's going on? When is there ever going to be peace in South Sudan?
There will be peace. I'm sure there will be peace. But that is a peace where, I don't think side characters like Dr. Machar and others should not be part of it. But our people are very peaceful.
Would you like to see him dead?
Well, death is not really, it is too big for me to say. Because somebody who created him knows the purpose why he was created. Mm. And that person is the one who knows when you will take all of us. Mm.
Okay, Mr. President, how do you reassure people that Juba will be safe? Because, you know, the talk out there is Juba is going to be overrun any day now.
Juba, nobody will overrun. Who will overrun it? Who will overrun it? Nobody will overrun Juba.
How do you reassure people?
There is, now that since you came, did you hear any bullet being fired?
No.
In Juba?
Not no. Today.
Even since that day when I declared ceasefire, that was the end. The guns went silent. That was on the 11th of this of last month.
July, yes. Mm. And what's to not stop the guns from coming from being fired up again? What's to not stop it? Are you going to stop it? Are you going to your people, your army?
Now we are already doing it. We are not doing it. The army is very disciplined now, have accepted to cease fire and only to wait to fight on self-defense.
Yeah.
If they are attacked.
Well, some of the people who aren't very comfortable with the security situation is IGAD. You know this. On this coming Friday, there's a meeting between IGAD, the five countries, and the African Union. And they want an intervention force, Mr. President, which you have been fighting, which you have been resisting.
Well, I don't see the reason why there should be a foreign intervention to come and do what now?
To come
there
and
is no fighting
citizens.
In Juba. There is no fighting in Juba. Whom are you coming to protect the civilians from?
The civilians still feel unsafe, Mr. President. That's the thing, because
under their own government?
Well, tens of thousands have died since 2013.
Well, that was in what was done by Machar. And this is what he wanted to happen this time. But this time people have really known what was going to happen. Mm. And so the army was certainly sure of how to protect the civil population. No stray bullets. That has gone to the to the surroundings of J1 here,
right.
Leave alone Juba.
So what do you tell IGAD when they meet on Friday and all, you know, the African Union and all the representatives, what do you tell them?
You know, I am a member of IGAD countries. Mm. Although they don't invite me, I am a member of IGAD. I'm a member of the AU. I'm the member of also of the UN. So to come to somebody's house without his or her permission, it is a trespass. Yeah. Even if I go to your own house without me informing you, you will take me as an intruder.
Mr. President, you can come to my house anytime.
No, not at all.
Okay, but look, okay, outside of Juba, let's say, you know, some of the states around, especially in the north, where we've been hearing stories of people being, you know, mass crimes being committed, whether it's crimes against humanity or, you know, war crimes being committed. People in those villages, in those towns, they don't feel safe, Mr. President.
They are safe. And if you want, for example, to bring in foreign troops, we have more than 12,000 here.
UN troops, right? Or AU troops, yes.
So can they not protect the civil population in South Sudan? Because insecurity is not all over in South Sudan. There are areas that people are now talking about. Can these 12,000 and a half not secure them?
So you prefer to have your own troops protect your own people?
Exactly.
You feel confident about that?
I'm confident.
And you don't want people interfering in the affairs of South Sudan?
If they want foreign troops, here is the UN forces. In Juba, they are in Wau, they are in Malakal, they are in Bor, they are in Bantu. Mm.
Would you want their mission objectives to be changed from peace and, you know, from peacekeeping to peace enforcing?
We don't even need them.
You don't need those troops?
We don't need them.
Mr. President, you can't do all this by yourself. You know that.
No. It is the people who are coming in, actually, who are now confusing the people of South Sudan. Yeah.
So you want to go it alone?
If they want to sponsor peace, let us talk with them to see. And that, you know, if it is the implementation of the agreement, it cannot be done by force. We are doing it alone now.
Do you feel isolated? Do you feel isolated from the rest of the world?
Well, I'm not told that you know you are isolated.
Do you feel that the world has turned its back on you?
Well, whatever they are doing, it is not me to tell them that you have turned your backs. I know who have turned their backs. Mm. And I know who have not yet turned their backs. They are waiting to see what is it that we are doing.
Are you disappointed in some countries? Let's say the United States. Because let's face it, you were very close to George W. Bush's administration. You're very close. You visited the White House 3 times, even before you were president. In Obama's White House, which happened under... Your independence happened under his watch. You haven't been invited. You only met him on the sidelines of the UN once.
Mm-hmm.
You disappointed?
That is a great disappointment. Yeah. But what can I do? He is the president of his country, which is a superpower in the world. Even if I'm disappointed, what do you think I can do to him?
Well, you can tell him, look, Mr. President, your administration was very supportive of South Sudan. Suddenly, you're shutting the door on us. Why?
Well, I have many other venues of saying it.
If he was here in this room with you now, Mr. President, what would you tell him? If he, let's say, showed up in Juba, Obama.
If he shows up in Juba, I will receive him very warmly. And when later on we sit down to talk, we go to business, I will tell him where I'm disappointed and where I really still stand with him.
Mm-hmm. If America had been supportive of you more since 2011, do you think Juba would have gone far, a lot farther than it is today?
If there was no war in Juba in 2013, would have gone very far even without America.
So when you go to sleep at night, do you tell yourself, listen, this job is just, this is a huge task here, and very few people are grateful?
Well, when I came to this office, I knew it was not easy. It was difficult because we fought for 21 years, of which I was one of the leading commanders in the battlefield with my late brother, Dr. John. We were many, including Dr. Machar, but all our colleagues decided to abandon us and they wanted to make a shortcut that they can go to Khartoum, make very fake agreements, thinking that that would be the best way to achieve peace in South Sudan. But when that thing did not work, Machar came back. The rest went and died there. But Machar came back. And we received him. We received him and he became number 3.
But he wanted to be number 1.
Yes, of course. When he ran away first, he disagreed with Dr. John. And he went to Khartoum, making what is called Khartoum Peace Agreement, which was concluded in Khartoum. If I fight you, my friend, I cannot go to your house. And then we signed the agreement there that we have reached an agreement, a peace agreement, in your house without any ground. It is not peace. It is a surrender. That means I have surrendered to you.
Right.
And this is what they all did. But when it did not work, they came back to us.
Have you ever thought of stepping down, resigning, walking away from all this?
I can do it, but let me tell you this. If I leave this year today, you will be talking about genocide in South Sudan, which you people are now saying when it has not come. Even if Riek has succeeded on the 8th of July to kill me, I don't think that he would have come to Juba today.
Well, Mr. President, let's take a break, come back, talk about Kenyans. Your relationship with Kenya is very close, very warm, but Kenyan banks are crying foul because your economy is in a tailspin, Mr. President. Let's face it, you have major problems, not just political and military, but your economy as well. Let's talk about that after we get come to break.
Okay.
We are live in the South Sudanese capital, Juba, with President Salva Kiir Mayardit. It's a special Jeff Koinange Live. We'll take a break, come back, plenty more ahead. Stay with us. We are back in a moment. And welcome back to a special Jeff Koinange Live from Juba, the capital of Africa's youngest nation, South Sudan. Barely 5 years old, so many challenges. One man could hold the key to the future. And we are live with him in an exclusive one-on-one, South Sudan's President Salva Kiir Mayardit. So, Mr. President, as I was saying before the break, your relationship with Kenya, very close, very warm. Lots of Kenyans, maybe up to half a million Kenyans living and working in South Sudan. Incredible number. But a lot of them fled after July 7th. They fled because, and this is the second time in 5 years, so they're very worried about coming back, Mr. President. First of all, how do you reassure Kenyans? Come back to Juba, come back to South Sudan, your safety will be guaranteed.
You know, we don't have any problem with the Kenyan people. Kenya gave us sanctuary during the war, and Kenya was the bridge to South Sudan, where the something called Operation Lifeline Sudan was established, so that the UN agencies were based in Kenya, and their operations were coming to South Sudan on a regular basis to save the people who were caught up in the war zone. So we did not have any problem. Our children were in Kenya. We also, the leaders, go to Kenya. We mixed with them. We made so many friends among the Kenyans. So we don't have any problem with them. When peace came, before we could become independent, Kenyans, Ugandans, Ethiopians, Eritreans, many others from West Africa, from wherever they come from, they came to South Sudan. And they established businesses there.
A lot of them? A lot of them have now fled, gone back.
Yeah. The people who are going back because maybe of what happened in 2013, but not of today. One is that of the 2013 ringing in minds. And number two, the propaganda being waged against our country by the people who want South Sudan to sink further down, deep into the ocean. This is why they are running away, because they are being scared. Including our own South Sudanese, they are now crossing the borders. Those who have close relatives in Uganda are crossing to Uganda. Those who think that they know Kenya is nearer to them, they are crossing to Kenya.
Yeah.
So it is not only the business people in Kenya. That thing has effects on the economy. I don't deny that. And so, what is it? How can I assure them?
Yeah.
Even if I tell them that, you know, come back, you have no danger. And they don't see it by themselves. They will not accept what I'm saying. Mm. The only thing to convince them is to keep the guns silent, the way they are now.
Yeah. Are you going to guarantee that?
I can guarantee that.
Mm. I was talking to some senior bankers in Nairobi, and you know, KCB, Equity, CFC, Stanbic, big here. But they were complaining now that, you know, we can't get any money out. The dollar's being held. The banks are holding the dollars because your economy is in major, major trouble.
Right.
Would you tell them?
It was not my making. Even in Kenya, there are banks also who have suffered the same fate that our banks are suffering. But whose mistake is it? We in South Sudan were depending, our economy was based on one source of income. That is oil. But with our troubles in South Sudan, oil also suffered its own fate, that the oil prices internationally dropped. Mm. Number two, our own oil production got reduced because of the war. Some of the wells that were functioning were destroyed by the rebels, so they have to be shut down. So that thing cannot make in any war situation, economy cannot grow except when you stop war and you resume the production of the oil. This is when you will come up again.
Yeah, but it didn't help, Mr. President, when some of your ministers and some senior people in government were stealing money, corruption.
Right.
You know, they say maybe $3 billion in the last 5 years. How?
What is the source of this war now? The source of this war was that I charged the ministers to return what they have taken. Or else, I will go and look for the banks that they have hidden the money in, and I will take measures against them. This is why those of Machar staged the coup to defend themselves. And to be frank with you, some of my money are banked in Kenya.
From these corrupt people?
From these corrupt people.
They're hiding it in Kenya?
They are hiding it in Kenya.
You know this?
And they have refused to reveal.
But you know this for a fact?
Okay. So what is it?
You have your hands tied behind your back, Mr. President. That's what it is. Mm-hmm. You're trying to get your money. You're trying to throw people in jail. Mm-hmm. Everyone's fighting you.
I have written even to President Obama to tell him that, they helped me to recover this money, because some money is hidden in the U.S. Mm-hmm. Because some of these ministers have bought apartments, yes. They have bought very beautiful houses, yes. Villas in America.
Yeah.
How did they take this money there to buy? The money is there, but do you know what was told to me was that they always don't expose their customers unless if I know the names of the banks and the bank the account numbers and the names of the people. This one, they will now help.
Yeah. Mm. And these are your same people here trying to run this young nation?
These are the same people.
Mm. It must disappoint you sometimes.
Very much disappointing. I'm very much disappointed when I get to such answers. Yeah.
when people say South Sudan independence came too soon, you weren't ready for it, what do you tell them?
How long did we fight?
2 decades.
More than that. Fighting started in South Sudan 1955 in August. Except for the 11 years when Nimeiri, made an agreement with the Anyanya, so that 1972 to 1983, that was the lull that we did not fight, and resumed again 1983, all the way to 2005. So fighting has been so long in South Sudan.
It looks like it's in your DNA.
I don't know.
Can you transition, Mr. President, after what's happened the last 5 years? Can this country transition to peace and eventual prosperity?
We can. The country can. If we do it the way it has been planned, I think we can transition out of this crisis.
Will you reassure the banks in Kenya who really want to do business with South Sudan? Will you reassure them that things will get better?
I will. I can assure them, even now, I can assure them that just don't rush into your decisions. Things will get better.
How much time do you give yourself, Mr. President? 3 years, well, 5 years, 10 years?
Well, as soon as we silence the guns and peace become, you know, accepted by everybody in South Sudan, it will not take us that much time to recover.
If Dr. Garang was alive today, I think he'd be very disappointed in what's happening.
I don't know whether, you know, he would have handled such a situation or not. Because these things happened during his lifetime, where Riek Machar and his colleagues, those of Lamakon, staged a coup against him in 1991. And just imagine, Garang was in Torit, we were in Torit, and they were in Nasser, in Eastern Upper Nile, and they said they have overthrown John Garang. Even student politics are not like that. but that was the case. So yeah. Dr. Garang, if he was alive today, he would have seen whether he would have managed to resist these coups or not.
But
he will be very disappointed.
Yeah. Do you miss him? Do you miss him?
Yes, I miss him. I miss him. There are occasions that, you know, when we were together and such a situation happens, we would be sitting, two of us, and we will then, at the end, we will come out with a solution to that problem.
And now you don't have that colleague, that counterpart to
No.
It's a lonely job, isn't it?
Very lonely. It is the most lonely job because, you know, you lose your friends. You lose your friends. You lose your colleagues. I said the other time that it is a voluntary imprisonment.
Voluntary imprisonment.
Yes.
So you wouldn't wish it on your best friend?
Well, if your best friend wishes it to do it,
yes,
you tell him that, you know.
Yes.
I told one of my colleagues, the current president of Zambia, when he was campaigning to become the president, I told him, my brother, You do it, but you know that the day you will succeed, I wish you a success. But that day, you will find yourself that you know you have walked into a prison unknowingly.
Unknowingly.
Yeah. He said, what happens? I said, first of all, you will not again be allowed to go with anybody, with everybody. There are only ministers that will come to you in the office and all that. But you will not go to social occasions. Mm-hmm. You will not even go to your best restaurants where you eat the best meal. Mm-hmm. You will not be allowed to go there. You will be forced always to eat what is brought to you, not what you want. So I counted many things to him. Now when we meet, this is the first thing he reminds me.
You told me.
Said you told me the other time. So it is a good job when people understand themselves. Mm. Because you will work with your mind at ease, you can plan properly, you can do everything without any tension. You are not worried that, you know, some people are doing sinister plans behind you and all that.
Yeah.
But, you know, in a situation like South Sudan, one can be really think twice or otherwise.
Yeah.
Like when it happened here, and we were sitting on these chairs. What is it if I had just jumped out of the office and ran?
Yeah.
That would have been the end of everything. Even those who want to make business in South Sudan, they would have not thought of coming.
Mm. If there's one thing you could have changed in the last 5 years, Mr. President, one thing you could have done differently, what would it be?
Well, development needs roads. That if you have roads, if you have connectivity by land, then you can change many things in a short time.
Yeah.
And we are a landlocked country. There is nowhere that we could prosper if we don't have roads. This is what I had wanted to do, to link up with the Sudan, mm-hmm. to link up with the neighboring countries, Uganda, Kenya, mm-hmm. Ethiopia, and all that.
Is there's still time for that, isn't there? There's still time.
There is still time.
Yeah. You were saying earlier on, you're part of IGAD, South Sudan. South Sudan is obviously part of the African Union, but they don't give you the respect you deserve. Is that how you feel?
Yeah, exactly.
Mm. Mm. Would you say
and
to...
especially after this, because they leave the criminal and they put the blame on me. Mm. Like now, the last one, it was a palace coup, which was staged by Dr. Machar. Mm. Who among these presidents can leave that person to go, get away with it? Riek Machar was in my hands here. If I was just to turn his pistol and shoot him, who would have blamed me?
Nobody.
But they would have condemned me all that, you know. I lured him to the palace to come and kill him.
Right. Uh-huh. Which is what they say, which is what they would have said.
Mm-hmm. I did not lure him to come and kill him. He had the intention of coming to kill me. Otherwise, he would have found me with my guns.
Mm. And you know how to use them?
I know how to use them.
So do you feel like sometimes this job of yours, you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't?
Right. Yes. And so But you know, I'm happy that you know I saved his life. I protected him, and that is you know.
And if he comes back now, if he says he wants to come back, what would you tell him? Because you've already replaced him. You have a new first vice president.
Well, he will remain with me as you know. If he accepts to stay, he can stay as you know ordinary South Sudanese citizen.
You will allow him back to Juba?
I will allow him.
Let him stay here, retire, and
I'll let him come, and if the African Union and the IGAD want to protect him, because what they mean by bringing forces in is to come and protect Machar, not any civilian.
You think that's what they mean?
This is what they want. So I would propose that even a battalion, if it is the life of Riek Machar, which has become much more important than the lives of the people of South Sudan, then let them pick out 500 soldiers from this UNMISS force, which is, you know, there are Kenyans, there are Rwandans, there are Ethiopians. From these forces, let them pick one battalion of 500 men to protect Riek Machar.
You will give him 500 men?
As a citizen.
You will give him 500 men?
These are foreigners. They will not fight us.
But you're willing to protect him with?
And to feel comfortable. Because people think that, you know, if I find him, I will not talk to him, I will just shoot him. But that is not my interest. I have peace in my mind.
You do, huh?
Even during the war, I was not known for just killing people. One of the peaceful commanders that Dr. John had was me.
Is that right? Are you afraid when people talk about the ICC? Are you afraid that eventually they may come for you? They may come for Dr. Machar? They may come for the leading commanders? Are you afraid? Are you worried?
Well, I'm not worried because I'm innocent. I have done nothing. It was Riek Machar who actually provoked that situation, which led to the death of many people. I did not.
Mr. President, we're going to take a break, come back, because earlier on you had told us that it is safe in Juba, and you took us around for a walk. Stay tuned for that. Jeff Koinange live from the South Sudanese capital, Juba. When we come back, earlier on, a walk around the palace with the president. You know you don't want to miss that. Back in a moment.
I was sitting here.
And Riek Machar?
Riek Machar was sitting here.
And then you heard pum, 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 pum.
It is not something to be heard. You can even hear when the gun is being cocked.
Oh, Lord.
It is not far away from here where it started.
And then, of course, you heard from the radio that something is wrong.
So when, well, we knew it was the usual music. And so I told them, my brothers, let us change because we were too close to the door and the windows behind us. So let us change.
So you walked
led them this way.
Were your bodyguards panicking at this point?
At all.
No?
No.
People don't panic here.
They were just out. We came in here. This is the... my secretary, we came in here.
And you felt this was safer?
I told them this is safe.
Safer.
I sat here. Riek decided to sit here because he was supposed to sit there. But he broke the protocol. He sat here and James Wani sat there. Some of his ministers who came in with him sat on on that, and some said on this way. So we remained inside here, and we were supposed to address the. I was supposed to talk to the press because it was, you know, our 5th anniversary.
That's right.
Yes. So I wanted to address the nation through the press. So all the house media were here. Now when shooting broke out, we did not know where they have gone to. Some were panicking outside. And then they all rushed to the press room. And I said, let us go and address the
Press.
The press. When I came out,
yes,
I almost stepped on
The stage.
Somebody was here lying down.
Oh,
here. From the press.
Right.
So we came here.
And they were all over the floor.
They laid on the floor. They turned the chairs to be on them. I was standing here.
Yeah.
Riek Machar was standing to my right. James Wani was standing there. So we made the address, telling the journalists not to panic.
Right.
And that didn't know what happened. We will not tell you because it is outside. And we are in the office here. But please keep calm.
And Riek Machar was with you?
He was with me here. After I have talked, I gave him the chance also to talk. The same thing went to James Wani. He came and talked. After we have calmed down the press people, we went back. After fighting was not stopping, but it has a bit subsided. We decided that, you know, this is the time that I should now address the nation so that it can be taken to the to the TV, to the, so that, you know, it
could be reassured.
So we went back to go and talk. After that, we came. Now there was no fighting.
It was quiet.
It was quiet. And my officers came to tell me that, you know, it is now clear. Dr. Riek, while we were sitting, knew that, you know, these are his people. But why did they do that? It is something that I cannot answer by that time. Because he knew. And he wanted to pretend not to know.
Right.
I said, okay. Now let us see how to take all the media houses, members that came. How do we take them back to their offices?
Safely.
Safely, so that they can go and report what they have seen. And it was rather difficult. So we took APCs and more personal carriers.
Correct.
This is where we put them in.
And
they
home.
Were escorted to their offices. After that, we took our own staff from the office. They went to their places. The next was how to take Riek to his house. And this is why I have remained in. I did not allow him to remain alone. Because there were very angry people. Those who might have lost their relatives in the action.
Yep.
Some have lost their very good friends. So it was a mixed feeling. And you never know who will do what.
Mm. So what'd you do?
So I kept remaining with him to assure him, at least to give him courage.
Was he panicking? What was he saying then?
Of course, you know, he was not panicking in the fact that, you know, you can see from his face that he was shaken. Mm. He was afraid. Mm. Now, when we have cleared everybody, I said, bring the convoy of Dr. Riek so that he leaves. Now it was difficult to find a car. His cars were either demolished or disabled and cannot take him from here. I said, okay, go and bring my car.
Your official car?
My official car was brought from behind the fence. It was brought in, and this is the car Dr. Riek has to live with.
You put him in your car?
I took him from here.
So you brought him here?
The car was parked here.
Right.
One of the men here shoots at him, will hit me first.
You were covering him?
Covering him. And I was the one who opened the door of the car.
And let him in?
And let him in. So, that is how it happened.
Do you ever fear for your life, Mr. President? Are you ever afraid? We can walk a little bit. Is it raining still? Do you ever fear for your life? Are you ever afraid? I know you have bodyguards all over and very loyal men, but...
I'm a human being.
Right.
And I can be afraid.
Does anything bother you? Do you ever get...
As I told you, I'm a human being.
Yes.
There are instances that you can forget your own self.
Of course. Of course.
And address the situation that you are in.
Yes.
And there are instances that, you know, you would want to run away with your life.
Yes. Yes. Mm. Do you regret becoming president?
Well, I don't know my destiny. I cannot regret. It was not my choice.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't.
I never dreamt about it one day.
Yes.
That I would become the president of this country.
Correct.
But I found myself in.
What's the best part? Huh? What's the best part about being president?
Well, I don't know the best part.
There is no best part? What's the worst part? Betrayal.
Just betrayal. Just like what happened.
Yes. If you had a wish list, Mr. President, to your African leaders, colleagues, about how they should treat this young nation, what would you tell them? How should they treat you? What should they do to help this country stand, get back on its feet?
When your child learns how to walk, you always support that child. Until when the child walks, you begin teaching that child of the dangers. If he runs, he may fall. If he does what, this thing may happen.
Yes.
And so, that is it.
And you
if I talk to my colleagues in Africa,
yes,
I will tell them this is your younger nation, and cannot be strong without your support.
Yes.
So I would ask their support.
Yeah. And would you still tell them South Sudan needs Salva Kiir Mayadit? It still needs.
For now.
Yes.
It needs me. Because, you know, I'm sure if I'm not here, as I told you before, there will be a disaster.
Yeah. Mm. And you're certain of that, huh? You're positive that
I'm very positive about that.
That there will be genocide, it will be all-out war, it will be civil war, it will be chaos.
And this is what I am warning people about. Because when they come in with the foreign forces, it will, those foreign troops may actually be the source of civil war.
Yes. Yes.
Because there are people who are planning for that to happen.
That's what they would want to see.
Yeah.
And what would that benefit?
It will benefit them because they will come in. UN went to Congo 1961. Mm-hmm. It is still there now.
Correct.
Yeah?
Correct. 19,000 plus troops.
And they are only concentrating on extracting the wealth of that country, taking it, and their soldiers get the huge pay.
Correct.
And by that huge payment, they have so many things to do. You know, they are always being accused of. Now, you can see.
This is what they were, the firing.
Yeah, the bullets.
The bullets.
And then the gate. Even this side.
Did they kill many of your soldiers? Did they?
Of course.
They did, huh?
Yeah.
My goodness. At the presidential palace. Mm-hmm. How do you do that at state? How do you do that at?
Huh?
How do they fire? How do they?
Well, they wanted who are behind this gate so that they kill them.
And that's why.
And with the response from the presidential guard.
Yes.
That's it.
That's how they responded, huh?
Uh-huh.
My goodness.
And if there was anybody here,
yes,
did not survive.
No, they're gone. And that's what I was asking you earlier on. Don't you get worried, don't you?
I get worried. I'm a human being.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, your family, I'm sure. Your family must fear for you all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to do this till when? How long do you want to do this?
Well,
after the transitional period, what are you going to do?
I would have just been out a long time ago had Riek Machar left us to go smoothly.
Mm-hmm.
I would have just establishing law and order. I would have just stepped down. Say, I want to tell the African leaders and the leaders of the world at large that rushing into the decisions that they are now about to take does not save South Sudan. If you talk about sanctions, you talk about the arms embargo, you talk about all these things will not help South Sudan. Because when you embargo the country not to buy any single bullet or a gun, then you are giving the upper hand to the spoilers. Those who are outlaws can get guns from wherever they get them from, and they come into the country with it.
That's right.
And your hands are tied that you don't bring any gun. Yeah. So I should tell them that, you know, you investigate into this thing first. Come and see by yourselves. Is there war or is there no war? Number two, are they actually for the defense of Riek Machar or for the people of South Sudan?
I have to ask you this, just for the record, Mr. President. I've been wanting to ask you this for many years. That hat, does it leave your head?
It leaves my head, why not?
When do you take it off?
When even I'm sitting with the people, I take it off.
I've never seen it leave your head.
No. You might have not seen me at the right time. Because once, you know, we sit in the meeting, even in the Council of Ministers.
Yes. Yeah. You take it off?
I take it off.
Okay. And at night?
Of course, nobody can sleep with the head on. Now, are we going?
Yes, sir. Thank you. No doubt, some incredible insights, and yes, scenes you don't get to see every day. A walk around a palace with a president. You can only get that kind of stuff right here on JKL, only on Kenya's television network, KTN. Tomorrow night, if it's Thursday, it's all about inspiration. Farah Hussein Malim, Deputy Governor of Mandera. You need to hear his story. It will no doubt inspire you. Thanks so much for watching this special Jeff Koinange live from Juba, the capital of Africa's youngest nation. Good night, good luck, God bless.